and I think I'm done with this interview.
Wait, well, let me just show you the contract. Okay, you pay $4 million to purchase the collection product? So that's what you call it. You're about to see something you're normally not allowed to see on US television. It's called investigative reporting. The real thing, you know, gumshoe, dig out the secret files, investigative reporting. I commit investigative reporting for BBC Television, the British Broadcasting Corporation, London, England.
On the next news night, 8 years after the hanging chads of Florida.
Every one of these reports was at the top of the nightly news all over the planet, everywhere but the United States, where the reports bounced off the electronic Berlin Wall.
Parties. Investigative reporter Greg Palast wades through the dirty political tactics. Newsnight, Friday at 6 and 10 on BBC.
Lately, we've been spending our time on new targets, the financial vultures. See, there's a myth that everyone is hurting in the current depression. For some people, economic devastation is a profit center. The story you're about to see, it's a tale of bribery, African dictators, diamond-encrusted ties, and elevator shoes. The hunt took us from the Congo to Switzerland to London. And finally, with the help of two detective agencies, to a mansion on the outskirts of Washington, D.C., and a pre-dawn stakeout just behind the pimped-out Cadillac of the man called Goldfinger.
One, two, three.
Hi, Mr. Sheehan?
Greg Palast, BBC Television Newsnight. I just want to ask you, Mr. Sheehan, why are you squeezing the poor nation of Zambia for $40 million? Doesn't that make you a vulture?
Our broadcast began with a message from Bono.
So, this is our moment. This is our time. This is our chance to stand up for what's right. We're not looking for charity. We're looking for justice. It was a beautiful day.
And it was a beautiful day. Bono asked, and the world responded.
It was a heartwarming story. All the nations of the world getting together with the International Monetary Fund and the World Bank to reduce the debts crushing the poorest nations on Earth and killing their people. It all looked good. Then down swooped the vultures, who bought up the debt cheaply and then squeezed these poor countries to pay them 10 times what the speculators originally paid for the debt.
5 years ago, Gordon Brown told the United Nations that the vultures were perverse and immoral.
We particularly condemn the perversity where vulture funds purchase debt at a reduced price and make a profit from suing the debtor country to recover the full amount owed, a morally outrageous outcome.
Yet today, the vultures are still demanding huge payoffs. One of them expects to win $40 million this week from Zambia. We thought we'd track him down.
We set out on our vulture hunt by going to their natural habitat, Washington, D.C.
To make sure our troops have what it takes to do their jobs.
The president is proposing.
Our hunt took us to a man who loves Cadillacs, customized with mag wheels. On the caddy owner's website, he calls himself Goldfinger.
Goldfinger. He's the man with the Midas touch.
Who is Goldfinger? We know that Michael Francis Sheehan owns Debt Advisory International, which manages vulture companies run out of the British Virgin Islands, including one called Donegal, which is suing Zambia. It's quite a complex web, and we hope Sheehan, Goldfinger, would untangle it for us. But he wouldn't grant us an interview.
so we thought we'd say hello to him while on his morning stroll through the wooded suburbs of Washington.
Greg Palast, BBC Television Newsnight. I just wanted to ask you, Mr. Sheehan, why are you squeezing the poor nation of Zambia for $40 million? Doesn't that make you a vulture?
No comment. I'm in litigation. It's not my
debt. Well, you've been avoiding this question. Aren't you just profiteering off the good work of people who are trying to save lives by cutting the debt of these poor nations?
No, there was a proposal for investment, but that's all I can talk about.
A British court is about to rule on whether the Goldfinger-linked companies will walk away with $40 million from the Zambian government. I asked an advisor to Zambia's president what this judgment means to a nation where the average wage is a dollar a day.
If these bondholders get their $40 million, what does that mean to Zambia?
The kind of money we are talking about, in excess of $40 million, is literally wiping out Zambia's annual savings arising from debt relief.
Sometimes it falls upon a generation to be great, an end to the debt crisis for the poorest countries.
Celebrities and pop stars campaigned for 10 years for debt relief. And the wealthier nations responded.
A child dies completely unnecessarily as a result of extreme poverty every 3 seconds.
Speculators, the vultures, realized they could make massive profits off everyone else's generosity by diverting into their own pockets the debt relief meant for the poor.
You look at an animal, the meat's all been picked off, the country seems bankrupt, and these guys can double, triple, or make even more on their money. Debt relief is actually just clearing a path for the vultures to walk in right behind them.
Here's how the vultures got Zambia. In 1979, Romania lent them $15 million. By 1998, Zambia was broke. So Romania offered to write off the entire debt for just $3 million. But before the deal was final, a vulture swooped in and somehow snatched Romania's cheap offer for his own company.
Goldfinger!
Michael Sheehan and his associates are now suing Zambia not for the $3 million they paid, but for the original debt plus interest, $42 million. But even bigger money is to be made in the U.S. courtrooms, where Sheehan and others are asking for hundreds of millions of dollars from several desperately poor nations.
And George Bush can put an end to it all with a stroke of a pen.
Under the U.S. Constitution, the president has the power to stop the vultures from collecting a penny in a U.S. courtroom. But he hasn't done it, even though just last month, George Bush publicly committed his government to debt relief.
And let us continue to support the expanded trade and debt relief that are the best hope for lifting lives and eliminating poverty.
To ensure that President Bush won't put his words into action, the debt speculators will need political clout.
The money trail has led us up Pennsylvania Avenue to this building, right up close to George Bush's house.
Sheehan's operation, Debt Advisory International, paid $250,000 a year to this outfit for their political advice and access until they got into a bit of trouble.
These are the offices of Goldfinger's former lobbyists, once the most powerful in Washington till one of their partners was caught bribing a couple politicians.
Jack Abramoff was recently sentenced to 5 years in prison for the bribery. His partners at the firm of Greenberg Traurig use more traditional legal means to stay tight with President Bush and Republican power brokers.
Well, the White House is just on the other side of this park.
You ever get over there?
Yeah, absolutely. These are the agencies and places we have to go to help our clients do what they want to do.
And many others besides Goldfinger and crew were doing it. Preying on third world debt is a global industry with dozens of players worth hunting.
I've decided to get out of town because I've heard there's an even bigger flock of vultures up north.
Here in New York City.
One hot dog, please.
Welcome to the Empire State. Home of the World Trade. Home of Biggie Smalls. Rockefeller headquarters. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm a BK bro.
Here, they are feeding on poor nations all over the globe.
36th floor, Elliott Associates, home of billionaire Paul Singer. Singer practically invented the Vulture Fund. In 1996, he bought up some of Peru's debt for $11 million, then threatened to bankrupt Peru if they didn't give him $58 million. He got his $58 million.
Then Singer bought some discounted debt from Congo Brazzaville for only about $10 million. His company then sued Congo and turned the $10 million into $127 million. But that still wasn't enough.
I'm right here, in fact, at 712 Fifth Avenue. Okay, is there any time or any place where I can meet with Mr. Singer? Absolutely no way ever?
Singer's company says the Congo government is corrupt and hid assets from creditors. Courts have agreed, allowing Singer to seek triple damages under U.S. racketeering law. They could get $400 million. Not bad for a $10 million bet. Congo was counting on George Bush to use his legal authority to stop Singer's court action. That hasn't happened.
Paul Singer is the number one donor to George Bush and the Republican cause in New York City. In the run-up to the 2000 election, he gave them $300,000. In 2004, he gave them $1.2 million, including money for the so-called Swift Boat campaign, which smeared the war record of George Bush's opponent.
His spokesman told us, "We have nothing to hide. We just don't do interviews."
Back in London, in this courthouse, the government of Zambia alleges that Goldfinger paid a bribe, $2 million to the previous president of Zambia to make sure they'd collect. And we've obtained this email. It says that they'll collect more money from Zambia in return for a donation to, quote, the president's favorite charity.
President at the time was Frederick Chalupa. He's now on trial on wide-ranging charges of corruption. As it happens, Goldfinger's old lobbyists are also experts on bribery law, the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act.
Even for a charitable organization, you simply can't offer something of that value to a foreign official with the understanding you're going to get something in return.
You can't say, we'll give the money to the charity, you give us a better deal on our agreements.
Yeah, that's going to be a problem.
Jail time?
Hopefully not, but you're certainly, if you're found out and the government can prove that case, you're looking at multi-million dollar fines for the company, for sure.
We showed him the email. He hadn't seen it before.
We're looking at this. This deal is going to get done for political reasons because we are going to discount a bunch of whatever to get to the president's favorite charity. Would that make you nervous if your client wrote that?
Extremely. Extremely.
Mr. Sheehan says it wasn't a bribe. They were only trying to help the Zambian people.
We offered to donate debt to a low-income housing initiative, which was a charitable initiative, which did end up building over several thousand houses for the poor. You're contorting the facts. You're on my property, and I would ask you to step off.
We showed this to the current president's advisor. He was not impressed.
When you are talking about any amount, $40 million or thereabout, to be paid to service some unfair debt, you are talking about in excess of 300,000 children being prevented from going to school.
Bribery or not, donation or payoff, British courts are only concerned with legal technicalities, not moral verities.
Zambia doesn't stand a chance. That's another $40 million for the speculators. And the debt relief that was meant for the poorest people on the planet, that will now go to feed the vultures.
After we ran our investigation, George W. Bush received in the Oval Office a little visit from two very angry congressmen who had seen our report from BBC television. Bush was on his way to a meeting of the G8 nations.
George Bush has flown into the meeting of G8 leaders tonight. Near the top of the list of problems, poverty in Africa. But activists worry that G8 nations' aid for Africa is being seized by vultures. In February, Newsnight exposed the activity of vulture funds. These vultures figured out how to get their hands on the money our governments give to help out Africa and put it in their own pockets. They do it by buying up old loans made to the poorest countries just before the loans are effectively written off. Then the vultures sue for 10 times what they pay for the loans. We track down one of them in Virginia, Michael Francis Sheehan, also known as Goldfinger.
Goldfinger, he's the man with the Midas touch.
I'm avoiding this question. Aren't you just profiteering off the good work of people who are trying to save lives by cutting the debt of these poor nations?
Well, there was a proposal for investment, but that's all I can talk about.
Goldfinger paid just $3 million for some old Zambian debt, but eventually sued Zambia for $55 million. Worldwide, Goldfinger and fellow vultures are suing desperately poor people for more than $2 billion. Our expose sparked an international reaction. The next morning, the Newsnight report was rebroadcast in America.
After watching our Newsnight piece, two very angry congressmen marched right into the White House and demanded the president do something.
I was outraged, just simply outraged to hear this shocking broadcast. It infuriated me, it made me angry. It was just on my mind. I couldn't even hardly focus on what the president was saying.
Congressman Donald Payne surprised the president with the issue. He was joined by one of the most powerful men in Congress, John Conyers.
I brought this matter up to President Bush in the White House. I asked him about vulture funds and did he know that some of the poorest nations were being taken advantage of in this highly immoral, ruthless scheme. And he said he was interested in knowing more about these vulture funds operations. And he said we would get to work on it right away.
That same day in Britain, a judge ruled that Sheehan and his associates were evasive and dishonest. Yet the judge had no choice but to order Zambia to pay Sheehan's firm its $15 million. And that upset some members of parliament.
On March 1st, 85 of them demanded a change in the law to put Sheehan and other vultures out of business. Ministers faced repeated questions about why the government had not clamped down on vulture funds, and some MPs weren't happy with the answers.
It is British law and British courts that vulture funds are hiding behind. What Gordon Brown needs to do is tackle our law, tackle our contract law, make it impossible for vulture funds to behave in this way.
The Zambia case especially drove their anger, raising the issue of corruption.
Here's something odd. Zambian officials agreed to pay Goldfinger $15 million just days after he bought the debt for only $3 million. Now, why would they do that? Well, according to an email disclosed in this courthouse, Goldfinger said the deal would be done because he was making a donation to the president's favorite charity. Now, could the president's favorite charity actually be the president himself?
This was the president at the time, Frederick Chaluba. And here's his favorite shop, Boutique Basile in Geneva, where you can buy diamond cufflinks and diamond studded ties.
Diamonds are forever. They are all I need to please me.
Where he spent $1 million on 206 suits, 349 shirts, each monogrammed with his initials, and each shirt costing as much as an average Zambian earns in a year. And 72 pairs of shoes for the diminutive despot, all with extra high heels.
On May 4, a British court ruled that President Chaluba must pay back $46 million he looted from his nation's treasury. Lawyers began to wonder if Michael Sheehan might find himself on the other side of the legal process, too. His lawyers had admitted that any payments to President Chaluba's charity might in the end have been used in a corrupt manner, but he denied it was bribery. The U.S. government started to look for evidence which might indicate whether Sheehan had violated the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act. May 10th, Tony Blair announces he would resign. The same day, his successor Gordon Brown issued a statement, "I deplore the activities of so-called vulture funds," and promised to work with G8 partners to curb them. On May 19th, Brown again told fellow G8 finance ministers that vulture funds were nothing short of scandalous.
May 22nd, the heat is on, as the United States Congress holds its first ever hearings on the Vultures. Here, Congressman Donald Payne is taking testimony from activists, including actor Danny Glover.
These vulture funds swoop in and seized
our. I drove out to New Jersey, into Congressman Payne's district, to find out what moved him to take on the vulture funds.
I woke up this morning and got myself a gun.
He told me that thinking about the vultures seizing money from the starving put an image in his head he couldn't shake.
You know, it reminded me of that picture, you know, that Pulitzer Prize picture of the vulture following a child, was just waiting for the child to die. The photographer that took the picture actually committed suicide. It just conjured up people just taking blood out of a country's lifeline.
The vultures have already sucked up about $1 billion in aid meant for the poorest nations, according to the World Bank in Washington.
The money for debt relief comes from those buildings over there, the World Bank and the IMF, and from the U.S. and British taxpayer. But before it can get to the poor people of Zambia, it somehow ends up right in this building, the offices of Debt Advisory International and its principal, Mr. Sheehan.
You remember Mr. Sheehan.
Goldfinger.
He'd rather not talk about his business.
He failed to show up when the U.S. Congress wanted to ask him about the bribery allegations, so we thought we'd bring the questions right to him.
Hello? Hi. Is Mr. Sheehan in? We just wanted to ask Mr. Sheehan.
Sorry, Mr. Sheehan is not here.
He's not here. Is he in the country? We just want to ask Mr. Sheehan why he didn't appear before Congress to answer allegations of bribery of Zambian officials. Did they call you? Did
it was? Right away.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Before Secret Service.
I guess Mr. Sheehan doesn't like visitors, huh?
No, not on the spec. Not when it comes down to seeing cameras and stuff. I don't think so.
Doesn't like congressmen either.
Yes, not.
Mr. Sheehan faces more serious congressional hearings later this year in front of John Conyers' Judiciary Committee.
Hey, Greg.
Hey.
Come on up.
So do you get bigger suites now that you're a chairman?
Yes.
In the meantime, Chairman Conyers is pointedly counting on President Bush to back action against the vultures at the G8 summit.
I'm absolutely counting upon him to do the right thing.
Back in Britain, MPs of all parties are counting on Gordon Brown to change the law.
There's a legal loophole, really, and I think he can close that. That's what he should be doing. He should get to grips with what is clearly an exploitation of the current system and goes against the spirit of the G8.
So, will the president and the incoming prime minister do the right thing or do nothing to protect Africa's poorest from the vultures?
Two months after the September 11th, 2001 attack on the United States at the World Trade Center, we got our hands on this document marked Secret, 199IWF, which stands for the Washington Office of the FBI.
The British Broadcasting Corporation had the courage to run this report.
After September 11th, the president had tough words for those helping terrorists.
And the people who knocked these buildings down will hear all of us soon.
But before September 11th, our president had very little to say to the Gulf nation where the attackers and their funding originated. America's attacked by 15 Saudi hijackers under the direction of a Saudi named bin Laden. I couldn't find a shred of evidence that George Bush knew about the September 11th attack in advance. But why didn't our intelligence agencies know?
This document is marked secret and WF, which means it walked its way out of the Washington Bureau of the FBI. It indicates that before the attack of September 11th, agents had wanted to question two members of a very powerful family for their connections to a suspected terrorist organization, Omar and Abdullah bin Laden. But the agents weren't allowed to. Now, what makes this family so special that they're protected from investigation?
The BBC took on some other tough investigations.
Here's a piece of paper that came into my hands from inside the files of a Texas official. It's part of the evidence that a congressman, George Bush Sr., helped get his son out of the war in Vietnam by putting him into the Texas Air Guard. We ran the story. And in America, that story, our story, was repeated by a reporter named Dan Rather. Rather lost his job. BBC Television never retracted a word, not a comma, of that story. So how do we get these documents? False fronts, false IDs. Apparently, today I'm N. Gregory Levy of something called Strategies and Solutions. We do try it the straight way. Before George Bush sent us into Iraq, we asked for the secret documents for the oil fields of Iraq. The State Department, the White House, the Defense Department said, we don't have no secret plans for the oil fields of Iraq. I hate to say this, but I didn't believe my own government.
Do not destroy oil wells.
The action is nothing to do with oil or any of the other conspiracy theories put forward.
Some people believe George Bush had a secret plan for Iraq's oil. It's not that simple. In fact, we found two plans.
How did I get the plan that they said didn't exist? Well, I started by calling the office of James Baker. Baker is the lawyer who represents ExxonMobil Oil Corporation. He's also George W. Bush's lawyer. Bush, oil. Called Baker's office and said, listen, I need the plans for the oil fields of Iraq. Spoke to his expert. Listen, I don't know if I have the same copy that you have. What's yours called? And they gave me the name. These are the plans that they said didn't exist. And the most important two words of the entire document are contents confidential. After the broadcast, my editors got a call from one of the oil industry lobbyists that tipped me off that I quoted. Said I wasn't misquoted. Palast never even spoke to me. I said, really? Then if I didn't speak to you, then who's this on this tape?
Before I was an investigative reporter, I worked for a living. I was actually an investigator.
Let me show you.
There. I did an investigation of a nuclear plant operator. We convicted the bastards, but we were never able to get the story out in the press. I decided to move into investigative reporting after my last investigation of the Exxon Valdez. It's been 20 years since Exxon's ship ran aground and destroyed 1,000 miles of coastline. But the real story was never told. You know, in the official reports, it's drunken skipper hits reef, just some drunk at the wheel of a tanker. That's just not how it happened. In fact, what I found in our investigation was that the radar was turned off because it was too expensive to operate. These are the inside documents that the public never got to see.
The story's not over. It's been 20 years. The natives of Alaska still haven't been paid. And the oil companies are still sliming native lands, as we discovered when we flew to Ecuador.
flying past the snow-capped volcanoes of the Andes into the Amazon rainforest for the rumble in the jungle, the biggest environmental slugfest in world history.
This is the battleground, the rainforest of Ecuador, as large as England, where the Amazon's waters begin their 4,000-mile journey to the ocean. To find Chevron's opponents, you need to take a little boat ride. Deep in the rainforest are the Cofan Indians. No one knows how many thousands of years they've been here, living off what they could hunt, fish, and craft from the river and jungle.
We use this to carry yuca, banana, corn, and little animals we hunt. In the old days, we hunted with blowpipes. Now I have a shotgun.
Their main meal used to be monkey, but today's menu is chicken. In 1972, a helicopter landed and everything changed. Chief Emerhildo Criollo says the oil company obtained permission to drill from the Cofan, speaking in Spanish, which the Indians didn't understand.
They give us candy, sugar, diesel fuel, and cheese. The cheese smelled funny. We threw it into the jungle. They say we could rub oil on our skin to cure aches and pains.
Oh, so they told you that if you put oil on your skin, it would make you better?
Sí, eso dijo, sí.
Speaking in Cofan, Cecilia Kenama said she lost a daughter to the pollution. I asked her why she blamed the oil companies.
Many children have died of strange new diseases only since the drilling began.
I lost two sons. My three-year-old went swimming and began to vomit blood.
The Cofan say the damage to their health was caused by Chevron Texaco. Chevron says that's nonsense. Let's go find out.
Ooh. This pit is the result of an accidental puncture to a wellhead. Now, Texaco said that when it was operating these wells, you didn't have many of these accidents. But that's maybe because of this. It says personal and confidential. It says reports are to be removed from the field division offices and destroyed.
Like that. If you're here with me, you could smell it. Yum.
The Cofan say this is standard operating procedure.
They drink this stuff, they swim in it, and they breathe it.
In Texas, they call this sky dumping.
That's not Chevron smoke. It's Ecuador's own state oil company, Petro Ecuador. Chevron's long gone. I can't show you all the leaking pits. There are over 200 on the lands of the Indians and settlers. Like this one. Most people would be thrilled to find oil on their property, but not Manuel Salinas. All he's got out of it, he says, is an empty oil drum, pustules all over his arms, and a stomach ailment slowly eating him alive.
I suffered these terrible, terrible rashes. It feels like my head is splitting apart.
And it's back over the Andes volcanoes, to the other side of the mountain, for the other side of the story. Now it's Chevron's turn. Satanic polluter or innocent victim? Let's ask him.
Scientifically, has nobody proved that crude causes cancer? Okay?
I asked Chevron's lawyers about the rising number of cancers among Indian children.
Did they show you a medical certificate?
No. And it's the only case of cancer in the world? How many cases of children with cancer you have in the States, in Europe, in Quito? If there is somebody with cancer there, first they have to prove that it's caused by crude or by petroleum industry. And second, they have to prove that it is our crude which is absolutely impossible.
Hi-ya!
So the Indians are attempting to do the impossible. They've put on war paint and feathers, and heavily armed with lawyers, they are filing a new lawsuit. They are demanding no less than $12 billion from Chevron Texaco to clean up their forest. A bunch of natives in feathers in the jungle demanding $12 billion from an international oil company would be just a sad joke. But across the Andes, in Ecuador's capital, something happened which changed everything. An uprising of indigenous tribes and urban poor, when I was here 2 years ago, forced the president to flee out the back door of the presidential palace. In new elections, the left whips George Bush's allies with the campaign theme song, the 1980s Twisted Sister hit, "We're Not Gonna Take It Anymore." The new government kicked out the last of the big U.S. oil companies, Occidental Petroleum. And just this month, Ecuador's new president, Rafael Correa, flew to Saudi Arabia to rejoin the OPEC cartel and told George Bush to shut down the U.S. military base in Ecuador unless Bush gave Ecuador a base in Florida. Behind little Ecuador is big Venezuela, and its larger-than-life leader, Hugo Chavez.
Buenos días a toda Venezuela.
Chavez has given Ecuador $250 million and the political weapons to stand up to George Bush. But Chevron has a few friends in Washington. U.S. Secretary of State Condoleezza Rice served on Chevron's corporate board for 10 years and is the only member of George Bush's cabinet who can carry 30 million gallons of crude oil. Chevron named a supertanker after her. Now, Chavez stands with Ecuador's leaders, and Ecuador's leaders are standing with those suing Chevron. Back in Quito, we caught up with the man who designed Ecuador's new alliance with Chavez, who this week becomes president of Ecuador's new National Assembly.
And he's architect of the plan to return Ecuador to OPEC and take down the U.S. oil companies like Chevron.
Assembly President Alberto Acosta. I asked him about Chevron's treatment of the Indians.
Chevron is responsible for the environmental and social destruction in the Amazon, and that's why they're on trial.
What if every small nation on the planet sued big oil companies, big U.S. oil companies, for damage created years ago? Wouldn't that bring the entire oil, worldwide oil industry to a stop?
What we should ask is not whether that will create chaos in the oil industry, but whether the oil industry is creating chaos in the world.
What about his new alliance with Hugo Chavez?
We don't have an imperialist relationship with Venezuela. We're brother countries building a whole new Latin America.
The conflict between Indians and Chevron is becoming a battlefield in the war between Bush and Chavez.
Not everyone's happy about the new oil order. One dissenter asked us to meet him at the Hotel Quito.
Si tu me miras. Si tu...
Salud. Salud. Salud.
This drink is called the Spirit of Ecuador.
Ah, that's good. But it's, yeah.
Fabian Losa is relaxing after a long day as Ecuador's top television newscaster.
Do you think Acosta's demands on Chevron and the oil companies are demagoguery? Are just
no? I think it's more dangerous. I think Acosta hates the United States, hates Occidental. He loves socialists. He loves Chavez. He loves Cuba. He don't like a petroleum company. You know, Acosta is very, very left. And he is the new president of Assembly.
He raises questions about the environmentalists suing Chevron.
Environment activists people are communists in the past. Now they are overgreen but red down, like a sandia. What's the meaning in English, Fred?
Right, like a watermelon.
Red. Yeah, watermelon.
Green on the outside, red on the inside.
As we left, the oil minister of the old regime waved goodbye and I headed off to the jungle to meet one of these so-called watermelons. This is the Cofan's lawyer for their last filing, 27-year-old Julio Prieto. He describes the difference between his legal team and Chevron Texaco's.
Here come us, in one yellow cab, two lawyers and one technician. Here they come, Texaco's convoy, with 10 big white trucks, and I don't know, at least four of them are full of bodyguards, well-armed bodyguards, because they still thinking that we're dangerous around here.
I asked him why he's not suing Ecuador's own oil company.
Isn't it easy to blame the big rich gringos who left the country 15 years ago, and it's a mess right now?
I mean, Petroecuador has done bad. Now we are thinking about suing Petroecuador too, but that's not an excuse for Texaco to go away.
And that really burns up the lawyers for the American companies.
Yeah.
So they're looking for deep pockets. Simply as that. That's just, all what they want.
They're just going after rich gringos.
Exactly.
Yeah.
There you go.
It's the largest fraud in the history.
Is Chevron Texaco just an easy target for lawyers backed by the new oil-charged politicians of South America? Or is the new oil order a chance for long-delayed justice for long-ignored natives? And what happens to this jungle and the Cofan when Ecuador's own oil company begins new drilling?
Chevron versus rainforest Indians, or Bush versus Chavez, whatever you call it, it's just another front in the war over that dark commodity that's left half the world in flames.
I can't say investigative reporting isn't fun.
These are the offices of Innovative Emergency Management. They're the ones that were paid $500,000 to come up with an emergency evacuation plan for the city of New Orleans before Hurricane Katrina. One problem is, I can't find the plan. So I'm coming here to ask him about it.
Okay, the question is, can you at least tell me if you have a plan for New Orleans? Yeah, I'm just happy to talk to you one-on-one. You're probably about 12 feet away from me. Or somewhere, you know, I mean, I don't know, are you hiding in this office somewhere?
Please leave the building now.
So quickly, before security gets here, I just want to tell you that this is Innovative Emergency Management, and it's very innovative not to have a plan to manage an emergency.
And I think I'm done with this interview.
Wait, well, let me just show you the contract that you paid $4 million to purchase this election, Roberts?
In this line of work, I get to meet an awful lot of slam doors and security guards.
It's interesting here, huh?
Oh, man, never dull moment.
One thing we never do in our stories is forget the victims of these crimes.
What's wrong, though?
They're just messing all over us.
What are they doing?
Putting you out your own house, knowing we ain't got nowhere to go. You call them back, Sammy, we could come back home. Then we get there, they got the police coming in, they're putting us out. And all this, they're harassing us. Oh no, this is not right. I'm basically between here and Texas. Coming to see if I could get my house back. And I'm in Texas. But I'm coming down here to see about my house. But they said they ain't letting nobody in all this. But where we gonna go at though? Where's we gonna go at?
So why don't you see these stories on U.S. television? Part of the problem is something I call lazy bastardism. You know, before the 2000 election, I discovered that Jeb Bush and Katherine Harris had knocked off thousands of black voters off the voter rolls. They called them felons, but their only crime was voting while black. U.S. television producers came here from a program called 60 Minutes. Their whole big crew dropped by, and they looked through our files, and they saw page after page of names of innocent black voters. Here was the evidence. And they said, oh my God, you would have to make hundreds of phone calls to verify this story. And I said, yeah, it's called investigative reporting. Voting games didn't end with the 2000 election, didn't end in 2004, didn't end in 2008, as you'll see in this film I did with BBC. Now, I know you're gonna say, oh, Obama won. They didn't steal that one. Well, let me tell you, there are 6 million votes that were cast in the 2008 election and never counted. Here's how it happened.
The answer is buried somewhere out here. This is no country for old men, or young ones for that matter. It's an economic ghost town.
This is the desert town of Las Vegas, the other one, Las Vegas, New Mexico, where they made the movie No Country for Old Men. For many people, work as extras on the film was the only work they had all year. Even the candidates for office are back on horseback to save gas. Odd thing, in elections earlier this year in New Mexico, 1 in 9 people who turned up at the polls found their names had simply vanished from the voter rolls.
I wasn't on the list, and I had to do one of those
provisional. Okay, yeah. Let me tell you, those lists came from the Secretary of State's office. The local clerk did not have anything to do with that.
What's going on here? We asked this man, County Elections Supervisor Pecos Paul Mays.
So people are losing their vote?
Yes, because they're not on the voter rolls, you know.
Even the supervisor had his own surprise.
I understand you had a problem.
I had a problem during the caucus, yes.
What happened? Your name was missing?
It was, yes.
It didn't say Pecos Paul on the voter
roll? It didn't say Pecos Paul.
You're the elections. You're the election supervisor. I didn't have your name on the voter roll?
Yeah.
The presidency could be decided right here. Republicans won New Mexico last time by barely 5,000 votes. Which voters have gone missing?
A lot of poor folk on this street. Officially, they don't exist. In fact, this whole street doesn't exist.
Low-income voters especially have been purged from voter rolls under the new U.S. law, which empowers state politicians to tag voters for removal from the list. Republicans claim these purge laws are needed to prevent voter fraud. We caught up with one of the party's top anti-fraud crusaders at a Republican celebration. Lawyer Pat Rogers singled out ACORN, a Democratic Party-linked group.
Are the Democrats using fraudulent means to stuff the voter rolls and steal the election?
My experience in Albuquerque with the ACORN group is that they were involved in serious registration fraud. My experience in Albuquerque with the elections over the last few years have indicated that there have been isolated instances of voter fraud.
It's true that several ACORN workers were convicted of making up fake names for the voter rolls because they were paid for each name they collected. But there's no evidence that any fictional voter actually cast a ballot. Rogers still fears they'll appear in November.
If you're going to go to this effort and this expanse of having fraudulent people registered, why would you do that? People say that there is no fraud here. There is.
I drove into Detroit to investigate whether Republican plans to stop fraudulent voters might also capture innocent victims of the economic crisis. This state has been hit hard. In Michigan, 62,000 families now face losing their homes to foreclosure on their mortgages. In neighborhoods like this, half the houses have been repossessed.
This house here is vacant. I mean, they're nice houses. Look at this house.
This is Robert Pratt. Nice house right He's here. Next on the list.
This house here is vacant. Yeah, it's empty. This house is empty.
That makes it impossible for you to sell your house.
To sell any house. This house is vacant. Then you look across the street over there.
I work straight with no overtime, no off days. I'm talking 7 days a week, 8 hours a day. Yes.
So you're trying to get these buildings paid.
Yes, yes, yes. I want to build. I want. I mean, look at our neighborhood. Our neighborhood is starting to look like a battle zone.
As the neighborhood spun down into poverty and violence, his son, just 12 years old, playing in the backyard, was shot dead by a stray bullet.
This is my son. This is my son here. This is Robert.
He's lost his son, his home, and now he could lose his vote. A reporter for the Michigan Messenger wrote that the local Republican chairman told the journalist that his party would challenge residents right at the polling station to stop them from voting if their names are on a foreclosure list. The Republicans now deny this, but the Michigan Messenger sticks by its story.
There's another issue. If you lose this house, there is an allegation that the Republican Party
don't want us to vote. And that's not how, I mean, that's like saying we're not a United States citizen anymore. You know, we lose our house, we lose our right to vote. That's not right. That's not fair.
This is the second time this family has faced foreclosure. Last time, they were thrown out by a company called Trot and Trot, a firm that evicts more than 100 Michigan homeowners every day.
Trot and Trot? I mean, come on, that's a mortgage company that here in Michigan that then got a lot of people and put a lot of people out on the street. I mean, to a lot of homeowners, that's like an enemy.
Home after home after home, foreclosed, boarded up, abandoned. But in an exclusive enclave nearby, there are no boards over the windows. These go for $10 million apiece. Money,
wow, no foreclosure sign on this house. This is the home of David Trot. He's Michigan's foreclosure king. No one has evicted more families in this state. What's this below the stars and stripes? Jolly Roger? It's Mr. Trot's flag. And this is Mr. Trot's office. And it's also Mr. McCain's office.
The Republicans are renting their local headquarters from Mr. Trot's eviction operation.
Greg Palast, BBC Television.
The Republicans wouldn't speak with us, but they deny they are going to use foreclosure lists to challenge voters. So we went upstairs.
And right upstairs from McCain headquarters, Mr. Trot.
David Trot not only houses the Republican Party, he's also one of their biggest Michigan contributors. He and his wife have given hundreds of thousands to the party.
Is it possible to speak to Mr. Trot?
Robert F. Kennedy Jr. found this more than astonishing.
That's kind of a scary thing, that you've got a firm that makes its entire living from disaster, and they're putting all of their money on the, I suppose, on the candidate that is most likely to bring them the disaster that they rely on.
And now to the critical swing state of Colorado, where SUVs have replaced the buffaloes that used to roam the plains.
According to this report, Colorado voters are going the way of the buffalo. They're disappearing.
This government report says that nearly one in five voters, 19.4%, were taken off the rolls in an unparalleled massive purge. The purge was begun under Colorado's Republican Secretary of State, Danetta Davidson. Her work did not go unnoticed.
She ended up here in Washington when George Bush appointed her head of the United States Elections Assistance Commission, where her job is to tell the rest of the nation how to run unbiased elections. She commissioned a report on election fixing. The report came in like this, but came out like this. It was written by Republican and Democratic experts.
They concluded that Republican fears of widespread voter fraud were unfounded.
This idea of massive in-person polling place fraud on election day is just an absolute myth.
The bipartisan team found Democrats were right to worry that legitimate voters were being excluded. But by the time Bush's chairwoman published the report, the experts' conclusions were turned upside down.
They left out a lot of the information that we provided regarding voter intimidation and vote suppression. They left out, edited out, the number of things that could be perceived as critical of the Department of Justice's handling of voter intimidation cases.
U.S. law permits political party workers to go right into the polling stations and challenge voters when they show up to vote. Experts fear this could lead to intimidation of legitimate voters.
Despite the election experts' views, Republicans demanded new grounds for challenge, they said, to stop Democrats cheating.
We know that their party rests on the base of electoral fraud.
The answer came from the man known as Bush's brain, Karl Rove, who demanded new ID voting laws.
I go to the grocery store and I want to cash a check to pay for my groceries. I got to show a little bit of ID. Why should it not be reasonable and responsible to say that when people show up at the voting place, they ought to be able to prove who they are by showing some form of ID?
But as a result, this November 4th, for the first time in American history, millions of voters will have to show photo ID. The new ID laws will hit black voters hardest, says Robert F. Kennedy Jr., son of the late Attorney General and voting rights lawyer.
You know, Karl Rove said he goes to a grocery store, he has to show an ID to cash a check. So why can't you be required to show a photo ID when you vote for President of the United States?
That seems sensible. However, in America, it raises a racial issue.
I have an ID, and most Americans have an ID. But one out of every 10 Americans don't have a government-issued ID because they don't travel abroad, so they don't have passports, and they don't drive a car, so they don't have driver's licenses. The number rises to 1 in 5 when you're dealing with the African-American community.
Altogether, an estimated 100,000 black voters in just one swing state, Indiana, will lose their vote to the new law.
Gloria, Gloria.
But when I stopped by the Native American Pueblos of New Mexico, I discovered that when it comes to voter suppression, Democrats don't have clean hands either. Local politicians wanted to reopen a uranium mine on the Pueblos' sacred mountain. The Pueblos were not happy.
See, that's a very secret mountain that we have. There is a place, special place that we pray for to have a nice summer, have good rain.
The officials gave the Pueblos ballots without envelopes. Then these same politicians threw out their votes because they didn't come in the right envelopes. The Democrats were charged with cheating the Pueblos by this man, David Iglesias, a rising Republican star appointed U.S. prosecutor by George Bush. But his bosses in the Bush administration wanted him to go after Democratic voters instead. Republicans bombarded him with allegations of voter fraud allegedly committed by Democrats.
Over 100 complaints. We investigated for almost 2 years. I didn't find one prosecutable voter fraud case in the entire state of New Mexico.
So the Bush administration fired him.
Not prosecuting innocent people led to your removal?
Yeah, I mean, they wanted some splashy pre-election indictments that would scare these alleged hordes of illegal voters away. They're looking for improperly politicized U.S. attorneys to file bogus voter fraud cases.
In the last presidential election, officially, 3 million votes were cast and never counted. This time, it could go a lot higher. Consider these statistics. 3 million voters purged from the voter rolls from New Mexico to Colorado. Challenges of foreclosed and other voters, some expect 2 million more. ID restrictions, another million. And then there's the chronic shortage of voting machines in poor neighborhoods, as in Ohio last time, where white voters waited on average only 15 minutes to vote, but black voters averaged 4 hours in line. It all adds up. And it all could change the outcome.
If you combine people who are disenfranchised by voter ID, people who are disenfranchised by other things, such as there not being enough voting machines, combined with people who will be shut out because they have been left off the voter registration list, that's enough to swing the election.
If the final count is as close as the polls indicate, the next man in that house won't be chosen by counting the votes, but by blocking the voters.
You know, a lot of Europeans wonder, why are Americans so crazy? They keep reelecting this guy. Well, the answer is, we don't. You know, they keep stealing these elections. And they stole it in 2000, they stole it in 2004, and they're all set up to steal it again.
In the end, after our report, the Republican Party backed off, and Robert Pratt didn't lose his vote. But he may still lose his house, so we're still on the trail.
Please turn off that camera.
Take it out of my hand. Good. Stealbackyourhat.org.
This is Greg Palast, BBC Television, and we're in the home of a couple voters whose votes didn't count.
Yeah. Did not fill in the bubble.
So why didn't you fill in the bubble?
Because I didn't know when you fill in the name that you had to put a bubble in.
Mom, it said you had to put it in the fill in the bubble.
I'm sorry.
Revolution called a peace revolution. Now let's take back America. There's a war and we're in it, but I know we can win it. So let's just take back America. There was a dream, so believe it. Now get ready to receive it, and we'll take back America. And when the war is over and we've won it, let's remember how we done it so we don't have to do it again. There is a peaceful solution called a peace revolution, and now let's take back America.
A
America.